I want to thank all of you for coming. We're going to do things a little bit different. This is a celebration of the homegoing of my sister. And we stood around her bedside as she was passing away, and we sang songs of rejoicing, and we thanked the Lord that we had the comfort and the blessed assurance that she was going to be with Jesus Christ. I could talk to you about how important that is to be able to know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior, and as a loved one passes off to eternity, to be at peace. My father passed away at Winter Haven Hospital back a few years ago. Some of you knew him. And 19, and I got the date, June of 24. And I stood and held my dad's hand as he flatlined. And I said, "I'll see you in the morning, Dad." My mother passed away in 2016. In November of 2015, on the 16th of November, my wife and I buried one of our daughters. She was about 43 years of age, dying with cancer. She knew the Lord, and it was a homegoing time for her. And while we miss these loved ones, we are still looking forward to the day when we shall see them in eternity. A week later, we buried another daughter, died with cancer. I know something about death. All of you here know about death. It's a sad occasion when we don't have the witness and the comfort of salvation in Christ Jesus. And so I just want to tell you a few things first before we start singing. I've got a two-hour sermon and scheduled, and some of them are going to come and talk. And so I've told them, I've got a two-hour sermon. You're going to have to give me time. So I'm jumping ahead of time, see. This is what I'm doing, getting ahead of it. Merilynn was born January the 6th, 1942. I'm almost 2 years older than her. And I don't remember her birth, but I know very much about her early life and the home we were born into. My mother and father were poor people. Mom was a believer and a Christian before she married my dad. And he ran what we call in those days a beer joint. My dad came from a drunkard's home, and he ran a beer joint. And he and Mom began courting. She was a believer, but she told him she wouldn't marry him until he sold his beer joint. Well, he sold the beer joint, married her. When I was born, my dad was not a believer. Later on, shortly thereafter, the Lord saved him. And so most all that I've ever known all my life, and all that Merilynn ever knew, was a Christian home, for which we're thankful for. My brothers the same way. We're thankful for the testimony and witness of my father. Most of you know him. He became a Baptist minister. Merilynn and I had a great relationship. She was my boyfriend. What I mean by that, I didn't have a boy until Rodney came along 9 years later. And the only way I could get her to play trucks and cars was I had to play house with her sometimes. And you know, that was kind of painful, but you got to do what you got to do, you know, that's how it was. And to hold a dial and rock a dial was not the thing I wanted to do, but we had a great relationship. She was converted before I was, about a couple months prior to that. She never was to be baptized because she was afraid of water. I was a resolved atheist at the age of 13. As soon as I would leave home, I said, "I'll never darken a church again. I don't." And so my mother and father prayed much. My sister prayed much for me, witnessed to me. But I resisted, as the man said. I resisted as long as I could until the Holy Spirit of God regenerated me and brought me to Christ in August of 1953. We're going to sing in a minute the song Amazing Grace. I went to church in diapers, and all my life I've heard that song sung. But on that night, on a Thursday night service, I heard him sing Amazing Grace. Heard it. I'll never forget it. Because the devil was telling me that God couldn't save a bad sinner like me. I'm a 13-year-old boy, but I was a terrible sinner, and I knew it. But they sang Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. If you know the history of that song, John Newton wrote it. He was a wicked man, sea captain, had a godly mother and a father who was a Christian, but he was an ungodly man, wicked man. And he wrote the song, Amazing Grace. But you know, you ought to read the whole poem. Part of it is in the hymnal there. I think it's number 226, and you can read it sometime. I saw one hanging on a tree. And that's the first part of the poem. The latter part of it then is Amazing Grace. So because she was afraid of water, and I was converted, and I was baptized the very next Sunday by our pastor, she said, if you'll let me, I'd like to be baptized with you. And so you may have seen the picture. We were baptized side by side. The pastor baptized us. And so that's been something of our history in our life together. I don't know. Merilynn hardly ever made any decisions in life of what she didn't call me and talk to me about it. I wasn't always the right one, but she would call me and talk to me about it. And I'd say, well, you've got to make up your own mind about that. But I want to tell you something that I have her permission to tell. And I have the permission of everyone to tell this that knows about this. Early in Merilynn's life, she became pregnant out of wedlock. She must have been about 20, about 22. We lived in Daytona Beach, Florida. And it was a sad, shocking experience to all of us. I was the one that had to go tell Dad about it. I'd rather have told him she was dead. Painful, sad experience. Years ago, they didn't have all the things that we have today, you know, and but, of course, Merilynn told me, and we had an uncle in Niagara Falls, New York, operated a rescue mission, and he also had a home there for unwed mothers. And he said, let Merilynn come up here and be with me. We'll take care of her. So she did. A little boy was born. I think she may have seen him. But quickly, he was put into the hands of a Christian family that wanted to adopt him. Years went by. She asked God's forgiveness and said that God had forgiven her for sin and fault. Raymond and Merilynn had been married 50 years. Just a few years before that, probably about 3 years, maybe, Merilynn called me, and she was crying. She said, Herb, I've got a call, and I don't know what to think out of it. She said, a man called me and said he's my son, and he wants to come and meet me. So what do you think? I said, let me call him and talk to him. His name was Pete Dakalek. Lived in Pittsboro, North Carolina. I learned that Pete had been reared in a Christian home. He was a deacon in the Baptist church, financially very well off. He said, I've been searching for years to find my natural mother. My adoptive mother passed away a few years ago, and he said, I'd like to meet my real mother if she would be willing to do it. I said, I think that can be arranged. So I called Merilynn, and I said, that's legitimate. And Rod worked with her. They met somewhere outside of Haines City in a restaurant, I believe. Is that right, Rod? Yeah, a celebration. The picture you saw on the flyer is a picture that Rod made when they met. Here she met a boy that she'd never got to know. Not only she met him, but she met his children. And I said, Merilynn, in one day's time, you became a mother and a grandmother all at the same time. And Pete brought his three children down. He's a fine man. He wanted to be here, but he couldn't come. And so he wrote to me, sent me an email, and he said, I want you to tell the people about my mother. Merilynn, I want my name to be put in with Merilynn's obituary. Include my name in my relationship. I thought it would be one of the last small blessings to her memory to be able to say she was a wonderful, loving mother that leaves behind a son and a family. I'll never forget the sacrifice that Merilynn made for me, the tears she shed, the prayers she lifted up for me over many years. I'm sure you know how blessed I feel to have met Merilynn and to have known her these last few years. I'm especially blessed to be able to share a little family history with my children so they better understand God's divine appointment in our lives. Please know we have been and will be praying for y'all during this grieving time. God's mercy and God's grace is not only forgiving, but it is also restorative, restores things and makes things right. He forgives and brings things together. It was a great privilege. Now, this is not going to be a typical funeral service in a way, really. We are going to rejoice and be thankful for the testimony. You're here, you knew Merilynn, you knew her life. Her testimony was, Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior. So my brother Paul is going to come and we're going to sing. I let's just praise the Lord. What number is it, Brother Paul?
That's top of the sheet.
Top of the sheet.
581. We're here because we know that our sister Merilynn, us brothers know that, us family know that, you can know that, as our sister in Christ is in heaven shouting glory, glory, glory. Let's sing. Let's just praise the Lord. Amen? 581, page 581. You may be seated. Pastor Carter, come please.
All right. Thank you, Brother Paul and Herb. You never know all the things that God has done. He's so good sometimes to take that looks hopeless and make a victory out of it. I do have the privilege and have had the privilege of being Raymond and Merilynn's pastor here a number of years. They served with us on the staff here. Brother Raymond worked security for us, and Merilynn worked at the college office there a good long time. And we go back with them a good ways. And, of course, Brother Herb Sr. and Irene were with us, lived over in the village, so we got to know the Hatfield family. In fact, Brother Herb Sr. shared all the news about the Hatfield and McCoy feud. I think I just had the Hatfield side of it, though, to tell you the truth. But anyway, go back with them a long way. What a family, serving God, raised to serve God, preacher boys in the family, and doing a good job. And we praise the Lord for that. And we hate it that cancer came, but our church is no stranger to it. We've had so many folks in our congregation, and the whole world seems like anymore that it's just increasing. But it's devastating here, but there won't be no cancer where Merilynn's now. No hospitals, no perishing away with it. And we got the victory in the Lord Jesus Christ, as Brother Herb said, and that's the whole thing that counts. The Bible speaks of the sorrow of death, parting of loved ones. But Paul said, we sorrow not as others that have no hope. What a difference. What a difference. I feel for the folks that don't have any hope. I've seen some awful experiences at funeral where folks had no hope. That's the pain. I've seen them almost pull a body out of the casket because they just could not handle it. And that's an awful thing. It's okay to weep at a funeral. It's okay to weep over a loved one. But our tears are different. And our joy is different because we know it's not over. We know the best is ahead. And we know that's true for Merilynn. We do want to read a few verses, and you'll relate to it. Familiar passage, John chapter 14. Speaks of where Merilynn now is at. The Lord Jesus was warning his disciples he had to leave. And he said to them, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you, I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. Well, he did the first part, didn't he? He went away, and he's promised to come again. Amen. I believe he will soon. Amen. And receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also. And whether I go, you know, and the way you know. Thomas was like me and some of you. He was a little thick. He was a little slow. So he said in verse 5, Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. I say to you today, if you've attended a family funeral, that's a celebration because they know where the loved one is, the mansions that Jesus talked about. But I'd say a good thing about a funeral for everybody is it makes you stop and think. Amen. And the psalmist said, be still and know that I am God. It will get us still for a little while. It'll get our mind cleared a little while. And I'd ask you to think and be sure that if it was your turn, the family could say what this family's saying, the preachers could say what we're saying, and give the assurance of being home with Jesus. He is the way. I pray you know. Father, we thank you. We can come to you in prayer. We ask your blessing now on all the following, the singing, and the speaking. Thank you, Father, for the testimony we've already heard. And thank you most of all that this is a celebration. It is a victory for a loved one that's going ahead of us, but one we can go and follow and go to the same place And one day, in a place where no counselor can come, no hospital to visit. In the meantime, we ask for grace for the journey and help us, Lord, to keep our eye on the goal and look ahead and look to you. Thank you that Jesus made it possible for dying for our sins, that we can have the assurance of heaven. Thank you for the peace the Holy Spirit gives to our hearts today about this. And we thank you in Christ's name. Amen.
The songs and the order, much of it, are things that Meril wrote down. These are songs that I like. These are thoughts that I like. These are participations that I like. And our next song is one that you and I love, but she loved dearly because she knew it was because of Amazing Grace. Take your hymnals, if you would, please. Turn to page number 202. Amazing Grace. Let's stand, if you would, please. Let's sing all four verses, please. Say it with me. Sing it like you know it, please. May be seated. Sister Barbara and Brother Rod are going to come at this time.
I want to thank everyone that has came today. It's good to see each of you. Meril sees you, and she's happy all over again, with no pain and no sorrow, no more sickness. And we rejoice, as Herb and Paul have pointed out, that she's not here. If there was a way, I would bring her back, not to suffer the pain that she was going through, the sickness that she'd had the last couple of years, but just to be in this world. She was saddened by the same things we're saddened, that we see in the headlines in the world that's upside down, that needs a savior to right side it. I never saw Meril witness as much as she witnessed the last 2 or 3 years. And she had a testimony to tell. She, every opportunity with doctors, nurses, we'd see her talking and telling about Jesus. There's a verse about charity. If I have all the gifts and everything, but if I have not charity, you know, it's countless. I was blessed to be Meril's neighbor for 3 years. 3 years before that, I would come down during the winter time, and she had a spare room, and I was a guest. During those 3 years, Meril was instrumental in Barb and I meeting, so I thank her for that. But during the times of being a neighbor and being there as a guest, I remember the charity that she would show. And some of you here know about her charity to her neighbors. There would be special events or family gatherings to get together. And she mentioned, she said, you know, Sister so-and-so's by herself this holiday, or so-and-so, they're, let's invite them over for the dinner, or let's invite them over for the occasion, whatever we're doing. She didn't hesitate to always open her door. Now, that's not a proof of salvation, but the Bible says by their fruits we should know them, and that was one of her fruits. She loved. She gave an example of charity. So I'm thankful this day that my sister's where she's at, and I'm thankful for her salvation. And I'm thankful for her witness. You know, we witness to people, we give tracts to people, we mention words. You never know where those words and those tracts will end up as far as taking effect. But God be the glory in all this. And one of the blessings meeting Barb is that I enjoy her singing, so let her sing now.
Meril said to me about 3 months ago, she says, you told me your friend died of pancreatic cancer. I want you to come here and sit down, and I want you to tell me how she died. And I said, well, it's easy. I said, your heart just stops beating. Getting to there is a little tricky, but when your heart stops. Raymond, a couple nights ago, you said goodnight to Merilynn. I heard the preacher say last night, one day we're going to say good morning. I sang this song to Merilynn after she had asked me about death. Someday here I know that I will travel my last mile, and on that day I'll fly away from this old world in style. There's nothing that can hold me here, some glory I will share. I'm going to say good night down here, good morning over there. Goodbye, goodbye to this old world. I'm making my last rounds. I'm headed now for glory land. Oh yes, I'm heaven bound. This world is full of trouble, and I know I've had my share. I'm gonna say good night down here, good morning over there. I hate to leave my dearest friends, the ones I truly love, but I'll be waiting for them there in heaven up above. When they lay this body down to rest, try holding back your tears. Don't weep for me, for I will be rejoicing over there. Goodbye, goodbye to this old world. I'm making my last rounds. I'm headed now for glory land. Oh yes, I'm heaven bound. This world is full of trouble, and I know I've had my share. I'm gonna say good night down here, good morning over there.
Meril, I'm going to ask my sweetheart to come up. Judy, if you would, please. We've had the privilege of our dear sister. And yes, she had quite a testimony. She would share the testimony that she had with anybody that came around, with anybody. Nurses, people in the elevator. All of us should have an elevator speech, by the way. We know what that is, an elevator presentation. You know, you got like 20, 30 seconds. challenge them to look to God. Challenge them to turn to Christ. Anybody across the street, anybody she come in contact with, the cashier at the Publix or wherever she was, Walmart, whatever, she had a testimony. She loved the Lord. But she knew that she was headed for the arms of Jesus. She knew that she was headed to heaven. She said, I want to stop this chemo treatment stuff. I want to go on to heaven. Sheltered in the arms of God. Thankful that we as a family have that promise, God's word. I'm thankful that our sister's not resting or sleeping anywhere. She's shouting glory in heaven. Amen, amen, amen. Jesus, 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 my Savior. Amen. Brother Herb.
My sister asked me to speak, preach at her funeral. And of course, being who she was, she said, now this is what I want you to do. She said, I want you to talk about Jesus. Don't talk about me, talk about Jesus. And preach the gospel. And I said, I'll do the best I can. You pray for me. So I want you to pray for me. I have a very serious subject that I feel like I want to speak to you about. I want to speak about death. And before I begin, though, I'd like to ask Pastor Richard Harding, a good friend of our family for a long time. Brother Harding, would you lead us in a word of prayer, please, brother? Amen.
This is a funeral of one of your children.
Yes, yes.
And she is surrounded by her family that know you as well.
Yeah.
And so, Lord, as already has been said, it's more a time of praising you and rejoicing than it is anything else.
Yeah.
I pray for Brother Hurd as he speaks to us today at the preacher's well, that your Holy Spirit will anoint them in the things that they say. God bless Hurd in saying these things that are on his heart. Bless us to hear. Father, we need your blessing to hear as much as he needs your blessing to speak. Speak to us today and help us as your children to learn of thee and to love thee and to bless your name. We ask it in your precious Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. My text for this morning or today is in Hebrews, the 9th chapter, and verse 27. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 27. For it is appointed. That word appointed is a strong word, by divine appointment. People have tried various means to escape death, freeze their bodies, searching for some miraculous cure. But the word of God says, it is appointed unto men once to die. Now, those of us who know the Lord Jesus Christ, I heard a pastor, a preacher say this, and it struck me as something that needed to be repeated. He said, the people say that only two things are certain and sure, and one of them's taxes and one of them's death. He said, well, for God's people, that's not always true. We have a blessed hope of the coming of the Lord and our catching up to be with him. Paul said, we shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. And that's what we look forward to. But otherwise, it's appointed unto all men once to die. I have a friend who... Every time his family would drive by a seminary, he would tell his children to look at that cemetery and remember three things. First of all, the devil's a liar, because the devil told Eve that she wouldn't die. Yeah. He's a liar. Our Lord said he was a liar and a murderer. Second thing he said, look at that cemetery and say, you're going to be there someday. So you need to make your life count for the Lord. But he said the third thing is, the Lord will get your body out of there sometime. Isn't that wonderful? Wherever it is, dispersed across the face of the earth, makes no difference. When the Lord comes, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and we which remain shall be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. And this old world and all the powers of this world cannot hold us fast. But it is appointed unto men once to die. First of all, I want to point out to you the universality of death. All people, the Bible says, tells us, Paul in the 5th chapter of Romans says, for by one man sin in the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. The reason why all sin, all die, is because all are sinners. We all were born in sin ever since the day that Adam transgressed. We are all by nature dead in trespasses and sins. We are sinners, born sinners, and apart from God's grace, we will die sinners. It is God's curse upon all mankind. I've been blessed to travel across most of the face of the earth, from Australia to India, to Siberia, Russia, and all across the United States. And I think about it all the time as I pass by those cemeteries, about worldwide it is that people die, regardless of who they are, how rich they are, what their color of their skin is, what their name is, how famous they are. It is a universal thing that all people everywhere die. And sin, death is the consequences of sin. Death is passed upon all men, for that all men have sinned. Whenever I hear people say, if there's a good God, why does he let people, good people, die? Well, it is because of sin, Adam's transgression. The consequences of all sin is ultimately death. James says, and when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And when it is finished, it bringeth forth death. Death is the consequences of sin. Our two daughters, we mentioned a moment ago, that died a week apart. Both of them were believers in Jesus Christ. Both of them were good Christian ladies. And we hovered around their beds as they were passing from this world into eternity. And the families were there. And I said, I want you to look at these bodies now that life is gone. And I want you to see the consequences of sin. This is where sin leads. Yes, they were redeemed by the precious blood of Jesus Christ, and they knew Christ as the Lord and Savior, but the curse of sin is upon all mankind, everywhere. Old Bob Jones Sr. used to say that the curse of sin is over all the universe, and all the universe sings in a sad tone. Well, it is indeed, my friends, that all mankind acts and behaves as depraved people, because we are depraved people by nature, and the consequences of that sin is always death. It always leads to death. Death is indiscriminate. Makes no difference who you are, how rich you are, how famous you may become. You cannot escape the consequences. The rich and the poor, the doctors, they all die. Many years ago, I read the poem written by Thomas Gray, an elegy written in a country churchyard. And there was a line from that that I stuck out that I've never forgot. Said the boast of heredity, the pomp of power, and all the beauty and all the wealth ever gave, awaits the inevitable hour. The paths of glory lead but to the grave. It is a curse, a consequences, a universal penalty that awaits all mankind. There's no escaping it except for the coming of the Lord Jesus Christ and catching his saints up. Death is powerful. The rich people die. The powerful men, rich kings die. There's no escaping of it. They try to escape it, but it is very powerful. It has the consequences upon us by which it is so powerful that it affects the body. Strong men die. You read people who are dying at middle age. You say, why is it? Well, suddenly there was a heart attack or something. They're very strong physically looking, but they die. Highly educated people, but they die. Very rich people, but they die. It is a consequence. You know, one of the verses of scripture that stands out in my mind is found in the book of Genesis, the 5th chapter. It says, Methuselah died 969 years old, but he died. Yep. It is powerful physically. It takes its toll on the body. Sin does. Wrinkles come into our bodies. Hair begins to recede. We have diseases and ailments. We talk about cancer. The cause of cancer is sin. It brings about death, very physical. But not only does it affect the body, my friend, it affects the soul. The dead soul that we have, that we were born with. The wicked go astray from the womb, speaking life. It is a disease that affects us spiritually. The Bible tells, the Lord told Adam, the day that thou sinnest, eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die. And from that very moment on, all people have been under the curse of sin, dying physically, but also dead spiritually. Spiritually. The world doesn't believe it. We walk around in good-looking physical bodies. We take spend much money taking care of the bodies and giving much attention to it, all the while neglecting the very most important thing of all, which is our souls. Our Lord tells us to fear not him that can destroy the body, but rather fear him that can destroy both body and soul in hell. Whether we realize it and admit to it or not, we have a soul, and that soul is an eternal being, existence that we have. The Bible says a rich man, being in hell, lifted up his eyes and prayed for a drink of water from Lazarus. It is that death affects us eternally. Not only does it affect us eternally, it affects you and chases after you even after you die physically. You know, the tragic is that people do not realize that this death is not the final death.
That's right.
There is an eternal death. It's called the second death. Our Lord talks about it. He said, "Where the worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched." This is not the end. People commit suicide and do various things, trying to escape physical death, but they may do that, be successful in escaping physical death, but there is the eternal death. And that verse of scripture from Hebrews, it says, "Appointed unto men once to die, but after that, the judgment." That's the time in which they stand before Almighty God and hear the awful sentence, "Depart from me, you workers of iniquity, I know you not." They cannot escape that. That's the sad news about death. But the good news is, death has been defeated by Jesus Christ. Isn't that wonderful? Paul says, "For I delivered unto you first of all that which I received, how that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and was buried and rose again the third day according to the scriptures." Hallelujah! We have a risen Savior, and his resurrection was confirmation and proof that his death was a satisfaction for the sins of God's people, and they will never be brought before the judgment again. There is therefore no more condemnation to them that are in Christ Jesus. Amen. Death holds no more fear. It is but a passing from this world into an eternity. Corinthians, Paul says that the last enemy that shall be destroyed is death. Yes, we must confront it. It is at our footstep. It hounds us all the time along. We do not know what moment death may indeed take hold upon us, but it is not the final victory. Death is not the overpowering power it is to the unsaved. God has ordained that Christ is our Redeemer, and he has defeated death for his people.
Yes.
Who delivered us from so great a death, and doth deliver us, in whom we trust, he shall also deliver us. Paul says in Timothy, "But is now made known by the appearing of our Savior Jesus Christ, who have abolished death and have brought life and immortality to light through the gospel." That's the good news of the gospel. The good news, and the only gospel that is good news, is the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and his finished work on the cross of Calvary, that indeed his death was sufficient for the sins of his people, and that we are no longer under the condemnation of sin. But because of that, we have eternal life. Because he lives, we also shall live. Merilynn called me a few months ago, and she says, "Herb, I need some reassurance." I said, "Well, I can't give it to you. Only God can. But I'll read some scripture to you." And I began to read to her from the 11th chapter of the Gospel of John. And I read these verses to her. The Lord Jesus Christ said, "He that liveth and believeth on me shall never die. Right. Believest thou this?" I said, "Merilynn, that's not my words. That's not some preacher's words. That's not even apostle's words. That's the words of Jesus Christ. Do you believe that?" She said, "Yes, I believe it." Shall never die. Isn't that wonderful? That God's people never die. This body is here, but she is alive, and she never will die, because Jesus Christ has defeated the very power of death. It holds no power nor fear to us. Paul says, "For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also likewise took part of the same, that through death he might destroy him that had the power of death, that is the devil." We talk about the powers of hell and the principalities and the demons, my friends, but God has indeed sent forth Jesus Christ, who has defeated Satan and death for the sins of his people, and we are indeed free from his condemnation. We have eternal life. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that all that believe on him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. What a wonderful news it is to be able to tell people that there is eternal life in Jesus Christ. And the glorious news of the gospel is indeed that Christ has died to redeem us from our sins and from the guilt and the punishment of sin. I've sat, and Brother Carter has sat, and we've, all you preachers have sat and talked with people who are under the great condemnation because of sin. I've been there myself. If you're a child of God and you've been born again, you felt the heavy burden, the guilt of your sins. And you looked and tried to find some remedy. How can I escape this awful judgment that awaits me? What can I do for my sin? The old songwriter wrote the song, "Could my tears forever flow? These for sin cannot atone." And you came to know and understand that all your good works were as filthy rags. There's not one thing you could do, and there was no hope for your salvation except that in Jesus Christ. And so, death is but a homegoing for a child of God. The story is told about a missionary couple, been many years on the mission field. They came home on a steamboat to New York City, and there was a great crowd there, and bands playing and everything going on, and they were standing at the rail waiting as the boat was docking, and finally some movie star came off the boat, and the crowds gathered around, and all was just going on. Supposedly, the story goes, the wife began somewhat to cry. She said, "We've been 50 years in the foreign field, and nobody's here to greet us." The loving husband put his arm around her and said, "It's all right. We're not home yet." We're not home yet. That's what death is all about. It's a home going for the child of God. We give her up and we grieve at our loss, but I know some saints in heaven are glad to receive her, mom and dad, but most of all, Jesus Christ. The Word of God says, "Whom having not seen, we love." We love with a God-given love because he has redeemed us from our sins. And we love him more than even our best of friends here on this earth. And if we had the choice to make, would you want to stay here with them or go to be with the Lord? We'd say, "I want to go see my Savior." And there's a heavenly choir singing, angels rejoicing because a child of God has come home. The psalmist says, "Precious in the eyes of the Lord is the death of his saints." I cannot help but believe that there's rejoicing in heaven every time one of God's children goes home. Christ loved them, died for them, redeemed them, and now they come to be with the Lord for all eternity. The 8th chapter of Romans, as of verse 30, says that, "Moreover, whom he did predestinate, them he also called, and whom he called, them he also justified, and whom he justified, them he also glorified." Now, the marvelous thing about those verses, those words are all in the past tense. Glorified, already been, as far as God's concerned, it's an accomplished fact. There's no if and ands about it. Every one of God's children that's ever been brought to know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, in the mind of God, they will ultimately be glorified. There's no exception to it. So it's a home going, but it's also, death is a time, but the first step. And I don't know if I want to theologically say it that way, but it's the first introduction, so I may say, to our eternal glory. Paul said, "So when this corruptible shall put on incorruption, and this mortal shall put on immortality, then shall be brought to pass the saying that's written, death is swallowed up in victory." We see it by faith. We believe it by faith. But I'll tell you, there's coming a day when we will experience it. when every one of God's children will experience the resurrection and the old corrupt bodies that we buried, that were indeed sown in weakness, sown in, we'll be raised in honor and strength, sown incorruptible, raised, I mean, sown in corruption, but raised in incorruption. And then will be brought to pass. Death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin. The strength of sin is the law. But thanks be unto God, which giveth us the victory through our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. There's a verse in the third chapter of Philippians, and I'll take the time to turn to you. I've read most of these scriptures to save time. But in the third chapter of Philippians, there's a verse that I like oftentimes to think about, meditate on. Paul says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm sorry, I'm reading the first chapter. Let me turn the page over. For our conversation is in heaven. Remember that. That word conversation here means your citizenship. I have a sermon I preached on from Hebrews that we are pilgrims and strangers here below. We need to remind ourselves, God's people, that we are but pilgrims and strangers in this world. It's not our home. We're just passing through. We get too much caught up in this, the politics and everything else in this world. When I go to Russia, I'm reminded I'm a stranger in a foreign country. Go to India, I'm a stranger in a foreign country. Don't even know their language. I'm awful glad to get back home. If you've ever traveled anywhere in the world, just even here in America, there's no place like home. It's a wonderful thing to be able to get home. Strangers and pilgrims that we are, these old vile bodies, they're but temporary tents, Paul calls them, temporary dwellings that we will someday strike the tent, leave it behind, fold it up. That's what we will put in the grave, a folded up tent. The body, is the spirit is with the Lord. Paul says, but our citizenship is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile bodies, that it may be fashioned, oh, fashioned, like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things, even unto himself. Change my vile body. It's been vile all of its life. Ever since I came forth from the womb, I've inhabited a vile body. And ever more often than I want, the vileness comes out. But God's grace and mercy, I've come to know the Lord Jesus Christ as Savior. And by the Holy Spirit of God, that vileness is some, most of the time, I'll say, subdued. But you who are saved, you know the struggle that we go through. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this wretched body is Jesus Christ. And I want to tell all of you, some of you may not yet have come to know Christ as Lord and Savior. My sister would tell you, don't let the day go by. Don't let the hour go by. Flee to Jesus Christ now. He alone is your Savior. He alone has, can redeem you from your sins. Flee to him. Amen. There indeed is several preachers here. If the Holy Spirit of God has spoke to your heart about the uncertainty of your salvation or about the eternity that waits to you, I urge you, go speak to one of them. For it's appointed unto men once to die, and after that, the judgment. And may God, the Holy Spirit, bless each of our hearts that we can rest in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. I want Paul to come and lead the song, It Is Well With My Soul. And would you stand with me while we sing? And after we finish singing the song, we will be adjourned over to the Forest Hills Cemetery to conclude our service there over there. It is well with my soul. Do you have the number?
Page 378. Stand with us if you would, please. Well, let me get there. I apologize. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well. Well, with my soul. Let's pray. Join us, if you would, please, at the cemetery. Flowers here this morning, this afternoon. You want to sing all the verses? All right, okay. Hey, he's older brother for something, okay? Though Satan should buffet, though trial should come, let them.
Attendance to please come. Brother Carter, if you want to join with me here. We will, the service is here concluded. We will reconvene over at the cemetery. Brother Carter, can you tell us how to get here from here?
Be best just to follow the cars. We'll follow the hearse. It's only two blocks south of us. And should have a policeman escort, and should be able to just line up and go right over.
Thank you.
John 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. I have an insert in my Bible that I keep there about this life. It says, divine life, speaking of this life. The same with the life of the Father and of the Spirit, and is in Him, not by gift, nor by derivation, nor communication, but originally and independently, and from all eternity. The fountain of natural life is in Him. He is the efficient cause and preserver of it. Usually at a committal service, we commit the earthen body into the ground from whence it came. But I'm reminded of John 1, verse number 4. In Him is life, and this life is the light of men. Yeah. Colossians chapter 3 tells us that we as believers have a life hid with Christ. Yeah. As our brother spoke this morning, that our conversation, our citizenship is in heaven. Yeah. And that's where my life is preserved. Yeah. It is in heaven where Christ is at the right hand of God. And this is the hope eternal of Sister Merilynn. That her life is no longer in this earthen body that is to return to the ground, but her life is in Christ. And now she is seeing the reality of that, of which we can just simply taste of here on earth.
Amen.
And so my encouragement at this time, as we mourn the loss of a dear sister in Christ, a dear sister and wife and friend, that we remember that we have the same, or can, through the blood of Jesus Christ, have the same life that she is now able to experience for all eternity.
Amen.
Because Christ is life. Yeah. He is the originator of it and the preserver of it. Amen. And if our life is in Him, what an eternity we have.
Amen.
So that is our hope as we commit this earthen body into the ground, to rest in the confidence that her life is eternal in heaven and ours can be as well.
Amen.
Father in heaven, we are so astounded by your magnificent glory, and that you have given us temporal as well as the eternal life in Christ.
Yes, yes.
For all who believe upon the name of your Son Jesus Christ,
yes.
For whom all the Holy Spirit enriches with this glory.
Yeah.
Father, as our brother spoke about the glorification that awaits us one day, it's as good as done.
Yes.
Oh Father, because you don't fail to do anything, your preserving power rests in your life and nothing else. What a great hope and glory it is.